Hello everybody, welcome to Life Uncommon. This is the first show in the month of March and we are excited to be here. My name is Andrea Rodriguez.
And I'm Alida Sharp, and it is exciting to be here today celebrating Women's Month.
Yep.
Tomorrow is International Women's Day.
Yeah. So this is kind of like our 1 year
Anniversary.
Anniversary for Life Uncommon. Tomorrow officially will be the day because we did start last year on International Women's Day.
Yeah.
Maybe we should have brought some champagne
or some cake or something.
Yeah,
some
chocolate. Cyrilla would love some cake.
I know.
Not just Cyrilla. We really need to plan this thing better. We need a big.
Yeah,
I want some cake. Yes.
Well, you know, having that long weekend kind of threw everything off. I wrote you this morning and said, I can't believe it's Tuesday already. How did get here so fast?
And I can't believe it's March already.
Exactly.
I felt like we just started, you know, this year, and we're already in the month of March. But it also is a good reminder for us, if we're taking note of how fast the time is going, is to, you know what, savor the moment.
Yes.
You know, because time is going by so fast, and before we know it, the end of the year will be here, and we will look back and say, where did the year go?
Exactly.
And what did we do? So.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, my grandmother just turned 98 years old yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And that one of the things that she said was, you know, just keep living, just keep breathing.
Yeah.
And I think what you said, that we just need to enjoy the moment because time goes by so quickly.
Yep, our children grow up fast. Everything is just, and so with the Women's Month, you know, the International Women's Day and Month, it is a good time for us to reflect as women, you know, on our lives and what we're doing, if we're making a difference. Because somebody said, you know, you can't take anything with you when you die.
That's true.
You know?
We might try, but it doesn't work.
And so, but you can leave something.
Yeah.
And you can leave some things. And the material things won't last for a long time, but the impact that you make, the difference that you make in somebody's life will last for a long, long time. They'll always remember that. So that's why I'm so excited, because I have two amazing women, or we have, that is joining us today, and we chose them because of the type of woman that they are.
Yes.
And you know, I have to say this before we start and introduce our first guest, because sometimes, you know, you hear all of the negative things about women, you know, the names that they're called.
Women in leadership, you mean?
Yes.
Yeah. That's true.
Not all of them are great and
nice.
Right,
because if she's too direct or bossy, there can be names that women get called that aren't pleasant.
Yes.
Yeah.
I know I said a name.
Don't say it.
But they are women like that,
That
we just can't stand. And some people, they don't even want to go to work because they are saying that one. But you have women who are in leadership who are doing an excellent job and doing the best version of themselves.
Right.
And because of that, they too can get the hater mentality thing or whatever that's going on, because we can't stand to see women that are doing well.
Mm-hmm.
And so I also want to touch on that later on, before when we are wrapping up, about some of the traits that we want to see in women and encourage in women, because really we have to stop this, they call it the crab in a barrel mentality thing.
Yeah.
So, and to just celebrate women instead of, well, she thinks she's better than me kind of thing, you know? Stop sizing up people.
Exactly.
Yeah. I hate when I walk into a room and there's women in there and then they watch you from head to toe.
And the sad thing is, that's universal. You know, every place I've been in the world, women tend to do that once over look.
Yep.
I hate that. Yeah. I don't understand why we compare one another.
Yeah.
You know, or we have to rank ourselves. You know, I'm better than her and she thinks she's better than me. I don't understand.
And my children is better than theirs.
Yeah.
Yep. When we stop with us, we start with the children,
exactly.
With the husband, with
or
all
husband.
Of this.
Yeah.
It's true. So I think those are some of the things that needs to be talked and included into some of these activities for the month to better yourself, your character, and all of that. Anyways, I done do my rant for this morning.
And that was without coffee.
I need some of that. Yeah, but again, I want to say I'm excited about our first guest because she's not just anybody. You know, she's a very special woman to me. And so I even make Alida introduce she because she laughing me. But I want to welcome this morning for the first time ever on Life Uncommon, Mrs. Sharon Young. She is my sister-in-law, or some people say sister-in-love. Welcome, Sharon.
Good morning. Thank you.
All right. Now you can say something.
Now I can say something. Okay, thank you. I'm so glad to have you here with us, Sharon. It's good to meet you. I've heard so much about you, so it's good to meet
good
you.
Thing,
good all thing. Good things, yes. All good things.
Yeah.
It's my pleasure to be here. Good morning. And I'm extremely grateful to be among two very enthusiastic, exciting, and wonderful women.
Well, you say you feel good because you're among superstars, and I told you, well, wanna be superstars. When we start to make superstar money, then we are.
Then we'll, yeah.
Yeah. But Sharon, I know. I just said you're my sister-in-law. I'm trying to pull up the bio. I know the bio must be long. So, and I know you're not the type of person to like that talks about yourself and all your achievements and stuff. Why I asked for the bio. Mm-hmm. But I know you are currently a CEO. Yeah. And before that, you know, a lot of other things. So would you please just walk us through some of your career thing? Help us. Give a little foundation of all the stuff that you've been doing leading up to being CEO.
Okay. Well, you're right. I don't like to talk about myself at all. I prefer just do. But I started out in this career very early in the field of natural resources management very early from probably the age of 16 when I started volunteer during the summers at the fisheries department.
Okay.
And then during my sixth form years at Belize Technical College, I met some very impressive gentlemen who ended up being friends with who worked at the department, and we were invited on many occasions to attend field trips with them to do reef monitoring, and that's how I was introduced in the field of marine science, and I pursued that career for quite a while. I ended up after sixth form working with Will Mejia, actually, at Tide.
Oh, okay.
He impressed me with establishing this organization called Toledo Institute for Development and Environment, and that's where my roots are.
Okay.
So I went back home for a few years, worked with him at Tide. Then I returned home due to personal reasons. I had to come back to Belize City to spend the time with my mother. She was just diagnosed with some very serious illness, and so I came back home, ended up working with fisheries again as a junior fisheries officer, and then went on to do my bachelor's at the University of Belize, and then went on to Audubon, working with Belize Audubon Society as their marine program manager for a few years, and then from there I went on to PACT, where I spent quite a lot of time as first the grants director for PACT here in Bamapan, and then a few years later served as the executive director for PACT. And then I transitioned a bit for a few years to B&E.
Okay.
I went on to the B&E Trust as the general manager for a few years until when I ended up back in government as the CEO for the Ministry of Natural Resources.
All right.
Wow. So that's a nutshell. Yeah.
The lady has accomplished so much.
Extremely accomplished, and you look so young. I'm thinking, oh my goodness, that's a lifetime career.
Yeah. But okay, and then you skip over the pack thing, but I think that I'm right. When I'm at a pack, she kind of met her husband, who is my brother, right, Sharon? I'm around then, you know? And I think my mother helped to play matchmaker a little bit.
Key in that whole thing. I knew Miss Jessie long, from a long time ago. From I started with Tide, I knew Miss Jessie. She was one of the few women that I met that I was, that I just bonded with instantly. I never knew Miss Jessie had so many children. More so a son my age.
Yeah.
It was at PAC that I found that out. We hired a team of professors from Galen University to do a study in Monkey River on the erosion problems there. And there were this Dr. Young was a part of that team, and I thought it was Roy. At that point, because he was a cousin of Roy.
Yeah.
I thought it's so. Until when we finally went to the community meetings and I saw this guy making some presentations and was kind of talking my language. And so that's how it started. And we just clicked from there. So
they really clicked.
That's great.
I remember conversations where my mom always would ask Colin to do something for Sharon or to contact Sharon for some reason, and the whole while it was a little matchmaking going on there.
I was like, okay, that's kind of this forced dance connection at one of the PAC Christmas parties.
Oh, really?
Oh my goodness.
She really was making sure you guys
got together.
She loved you, Sharon, right from the get-go. She thought you were perfect for Colleen. So. But anyways,
well,
we're
mother knows, right?
That's right. We're not here to talk about Sharon's love life, unfortunately. But I wanted to ask you, Shar, sometimes when we're young, as little girls, we start dreaming of the future that we want, or you would hear little girls say, well, I want to be a teacher, I want to be this, or I want to be that. Did any of those things that you, back then when you were a little girl, dreaming about your future, is this where you are now? Did you see yourself here back then?
Well, the funny thing is you always hear children and you encourage kids to say what they want to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sometimes you'll find children who haven't figured that out yet.
Right.
And I think I was one of those girls. I couldn't quite figure out what I wanted to do. I just knew that I didn't want to go into business. I didn't want to be an accountant. I didn't want to work at the bank. I didn't want to be a teacher. I knew that for sure.
Yeah.
But I love science. I always knew I loved science. Mm-hmm. And into my adolescent years, I took a keen interest on medicine, and I wanted to understand how the body works and that kind of thing.
Okay.
Of course, my limitation was money. We were poor. We didn't have the resources beyond high school, and so throughout my sixth form years, I had to work part time. In fact, I started working from high school, from third form, just to help pay for exams and those kinds of things.
Yeah.
And so I just ended up doing what I love, which was going to school. I always wanted to go to school. Nothing that I was faced with growing up prevented me from going to school. Mm-hmm. And I think it was because my mother always told me that, nobody can take away your education. Just make sure you go to school.
Yeah.
That was my plan, to work so that I can pay my way through school. And that was always the plan. I ended up in the field of natural resources because I love science. Mm-hmm. I love exploring. I wanted to understand how things work, how the world works. I knew I was going to do something in the sciences, but not teaching, because I love to be outdoors. Life happens.
Yeah.
Life happens as you grow up. You have to, at least when I was growing up, you have to do what you have to do.
Right.
Which
work,
go to school. At that time, Belize Technical College offered some programs, and that's where I could afford it to go to school. And I was fortunate to have been among some of the most prestigious professors in my time at Belize Technical College. I had the honor of being schooled by the late Mrs. Patricia Andrew, and she taught me chemistry. Mrs. Crawford, who I meet from time to time, Vernon Card. These people are who helped shape me to continue to pursue studies in this field. And then I went on to University of Belize. I met Pio Sake and Diane Wade and a couple other people who I admired and wanted to continue to do something for my country and help to build the knowledge of my country. And I think more so I found that that's what I wanted to do, to help to build the knowledge base of our country, mm-hmm. To know things, to find out things, to search, to learn facts, to understand what drives our country, what drives our economy. Mm-hmm. And the more I understood that, the more I value how important our environment is for our beliefs, because mm-hmm. that is what shapes our economy. Everything we do, every single aspect of our economy is based on our natural resources.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so that really has been my passion going forward in my career, to participate meaningfully in ways that I can to make sure we value what we have, we preserve it, and we make sound decisions based on science and based on policies that are grounded in our values as a people, which is the fact that we enjoy where we live.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So those are some of the things that have helped me to determine what I want to be. And I end up being a, I always tell Gianna, Gianna is my daughter, and Gianna knows her very well, she's studying math and physics because she wants to be an engineer.
Okay.
So she asked me, Mom, what do you do now? You know, what do you do from high school? I said, well, you know, I end up just being a paper pusher.
Uh-huh.
I sit at the desk most days and that's what I do.
Yeah.
He said, but that doesn't sound exciting.
Uh-huh.
I said, well, maybe because I have wonderful people around me.
Yeah.
I have people, one of my staff is here right now, Alex. I have some incredible mm-hmm. people who I work with. Who we take for granted every day in the bigger society. We get caught up mm-hmm. in so many public discourse that we lose focus of what really is happening day to day in government, at the grassroots level, with just people enjoying what they do.
Mm-hmm.
So I work with women who are involved in managing our water resources, and these women, they know. I mean, Mr. Neil, she's our hydrologist. They know what they like.
Yeah.
They're passionate about managing water, keeping it clean, so
yeah.
we can be drinking it, you know, making our coffee.
Right, right.
You know, I work with this lady, the inspector of mine, Michelle Alvarez. She is so passionate about rocks. I mean, I couldn't get somebody excited about talking about rocks. I mean, you know. So these, I have a legal officer who is keen on just making sure we follow the law, interpreting it in ways that are useful for decision making. And I have some very wonderful gentlemen too.
Mm-hmm.
Alex, I mentioned Paul, the commissioner Wilbert Bios. These guys are knowledgeable, they supportive.
Yeah.
They so it's we have good days, we have not so
bad
good days, we have bad days. But at the end of the day, we I think we leave knowing that we enjoy what we do.
Yeah.
So it has been one of those life. Or at least my life has been one of those experiences where you couldn't quite figure out where you want to go when you first started, but when you get there, you're not quite there yet, but you're getting there.
So you know, one of the things I loved hearing as you were talking was your passion, because that's coming through very clearly, but how you value not just your country and the natural resources, but the people.
Mm-hmm.
And people are also a resource here in this country.
Yeah.
And you mentioned women and men that helped mold and shape you, people that mentored you, but also people that you work with.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that is an incredible quality of a leader, how you value the people that are around you and how you're able to connect with the people that are around you. And that's amazing to me, because I don't think all women, not every woman has that gift.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Well, one of the things we do very often is have coffee.
Okay.
I love coffee. My staff knows that very well. So, and my office have the best coffee in Bamapan, I think. If you ever have a shortage of coffee, please stop by.
Okay.
I think I'll find it afterwards.
Okay. So is it time
for
us?
No, we have time for one more question
before
we take a break. Yeah. But I wanted to go back to almost to the beginning, Shara, where you were talking about how, you know, things were tough when you were growing up. It wasn't like you had tons of money poured into you to achieve your dreams.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes people look at women like you and they say, well, they've had it made, you know, life has been easy and great for them, and they don't see or know the struggles and what all it took to get you to where you are. And so I was very glad that you shared that, because I want to encourage the women who are watching, you know, that yes, because you've had struggles, maybe you didn't have money to go to school and all of that, but it's not, you're not the first woman I've talked to who is very successful But they didn't have money. They had to work part-time. They had to do all kinds of stuff to make it happen for them. And so I think that's key in us realizing that it's not just going to land in our laps.
Yeah. Right.
You have to work for it.
Right. Yeah. And it's not just about desire, because you mentioned, Sharon, that you had a desire, but there was also a determination to make that desire become a reality, you know, with your education. And that's important.
That one of the things I also, and I just wanted to stick it in here since we're talking about just our lives, is that, well, work is a part of our lives. But everywhere I've been, everywhere I've worked, we've always encouraged my team, whether I'm a part of it, whether I'm leading the team or not, to just do more than what we're asked. Do more than what you're being paid to do. Do more than just your work. And when I was at the B&E Trust, we supported a lot of projects in education, but we also supported a lot of projects in health. We looked at entrepreneurs, we looked at, you know, those kinds of things, and it might be out of the field that I am used to, but it opened your eyes in thinking that there is so much more that you can do as an individual. And I shared with Andrea our initiative of the cancer ride.
So which is I want we have to take a break and then we come back. Please tell us about that. So when I write it, I'm gonna wait. Okay, so we're going to take a short break and then we will come right back and have Sharon share with us about this cancer ride that you may have been hearing about.
Okay.
It's a daytime show, and it empowers women to embrace the extraordinary and go against the grain of the common.
I really like the song of that.
Yeah, I knew you would like it, because it's a really fun show.
It sounds that way.
It's a mixture of tears and laughter and challenges and human interest stories.
Well, you know what? I might just give it a shot.
Well, let's go.
All right, let's go. Hi, guys. Alida and I want to invite you to join us on Tuesdays at 10:30 for a new season of Life Uncommon on Plus TV. You do not want to miss what 2017 will bring. It's going to be awesome.
It sure will.
Here are some latest samples from Roots and Honors.
Just a glimpse of his glory, just a hint.
To live a life uncommon.
Welcome back to Life Uncommon. We are live here in the studio at Plus TV, and we've been having a great discussion with Mrs. Sharon Young from
the Ministry of Natural Resources.
Okay, because yes. I know I live over near the office, and we always call it the lands office. So then I got stuck. It's like, wait a minute.
Yeah, that's
what
okay.
I told you, Ministry of Lands and Time.
Yes, you did.
Well, a lot of people think it's the Ministry of Lands, but it's Natural Resources.
It's like, wait a minute.
That's how graphical we always like say wrong thing. But anyway. All right, so before we went to break, you were telling us about one of the initiatives that you are extremely passionate about, which is the Cancer Ride coming up. So tell us about that.
Yeah, so this is very personal to me, as I've been sharing over the last 2 years. This is our second year now, where last year there are 23 CEOs, chief executive officers in government, who are responsible for all the portfolios in the various ministries. So during the Cancer Month, or before the Cancer Month last year, we were just casually talking, and I suggested, let us try to do something for in support of cancer awareness. And I shared my experience with my colleagues that I went through cancer treatment back in 2003 after being diagnosed, and you know, I didn't have any money, and it was because of the kindness of strangers and doctors who were very supportive of me, who have helped me through getting treatment, finding the resources to pull through, and also the strong support of my mother, God rest her soul. Who they've all helped me to get through what I had to go through. So I know how difficult it is when people are faced with being diagnosed. And this is the second leading cause of death in our country, cancer, next to heart disease. For a small country like Belize, we need to, you know, we need to help as much as we can. So we all jumped, I mean, my colleagues all jumped on board to start a fundraise. We wanted to raise a minimum of $50,000, and we wanted to culminate our initiative in a ride to raise awareness for cancer. And so last year we planned on, and we had the ride back in May, which was Cancer Month, and we raised a total of about $81,000, a little bit over the $50,000.
Wow.
And we were able to share that among the three institutions, the two cancer societies, Belize and Bomapan, and then the treatment center in Dangriga. We had over 200 people participated in the ride itself.
Wow.
It was the largest social ride for the country last year. So this year I wanted to do the same thing, but we wanted to support the treatment center in Dangriga. With hundreds of people use the facility every year, so we wanted to see how much we can fundraise for them. So that's what we're doing this year. We're doing it in April, April 8th. May, we didn't want to clash with any of the other rides in May. So we decided on April, which is the 8th, the week before the cross country.
It's like a month away.
We usually get the support of the Cycling Federation, the professional cyclists participate with us. They help push people along if you're tired, so you can come out and ride and bring the kids.
Only if I get Joel to push me.
Yes, he will. He will. That's guaranteed.
If Joel push me, me no one ride.
He will ride, and so we start at mile 24 on the George Price Highway.
Okay.
We end up at the showgrounds in Bamapan. We start at 6:30 in the morning, and during this month, the next month, all the CEOs will be doing our own fundraising, trying to reach our target. So it's in addition to the ride, where everybody in their own individual effort are trying to raise the funds that we need to support the treatment center in Dangriga. So we want to encourage everybody to come out and ride, to register, to support in any way that you can.
So the ride is April 8th.
April 8th starts
at 6:30. And how can people register?
There is a registration. Registration, you can email info@naturalresources.gov.bz. I will send you
information on it.
And or you can contact any of your favorite CEO.
It's all over Facebook too, so people could find the information on Facebook.
The government press
well.
Office have the information. Janelle has been working well with us to get the information out. So you know, just even buy a T-shirt or in some way help to support raising the funds for the treatment center.
And do you have so let's say Alida and I decide we're going to borrow borrow a bike and ride. What's the fee? Is there a fee to ride?
It's just to register. If you don't want the t-shirt, then you don't have to pay the registration fee. Okay. But you have to register. So you can register and ride. Mm-hmm. If you pay the $25, you get a t-shirt.
Okay.
But there is no fee for the ride. Yeah. You just come out and ride. You join the ride at any point along the highway that you want.
Okay.
You start right. You join it at the roundabout if you want, and you end up. I mean, people do it all.
You know, that's actually
so you don't have to ride the entire 25 miles. You can ride 1 mile or 2 miles. Okay. It's up to you. Okay. And if you're tired, the guys will push you.
Yeah.
Okay. Or they'll carry you. Okay.
Pull you with a rope or something. I really love the initiative, Char. And you had mentioned that it's more than just fundraising. It's also bringing awareness to this cause, and like you said, it's the second leading cause.
Yeah.
And so, you could do the fundraising, but I think it goes hand in hand to also create that awareness as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah. All right, people, I want you guys to support this ride. Me don't want to ride bike. Me afraid of a bike. Bad. So I can't commit, and I commit on here, but maybe if Alida said, let's go, we might borrow an e-bike or something.
Well, last year, Mrs. Barrow, she jogged the last mile instead of running.
I can do that. I could run the last mile or three or four with you guys. Yeah.
I could walk. I might could jog a little bit. Me and Alida talk about what we'll do. I definitely want to support, because I know the heart of the people behind it, and I know that the treatment center that you guys are helping out is a great, great place. Mm-hmm. I've heard good things about them, but they really need money. They need the resources to continue to help many, many people in this country who are getting diagnosed daily.
That's true. Mm-hmm.
So, Char, before we let you go, though, I wanted to ask you if there's any life lessons or anything that you would like to share with our viewers. Majority of them are women that are tuning in this morning. Anything you want to share?
Yeah, there are many things that I've learned along the way, and I continue to learn.
Mm-hmm.
I use in my personal and professional life, and I can't seem to separate the two. Mm-hmm. My husband is a hard worker, just like I am. Mm-hmm. And my daughter will push her the same way. But some of the key things that I've learned along the way is that we're all different. It doesn't matter if we're a male, female, young, old. We all have our differences. But we need to use those differences to make a difference.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, if we can figure out and get past the boundaries that we set up all the time. Mm. You mentioned when you walk in a room, the first thing another female notices is what you wear. You know that you're putting up filters. So sometimes we just have to, and you can't, that's human. It's human for us to want to put up boundaries. I mean, an ultra wants to build a wall. It's human for us, but it's more important to remove the boundaries and the barriers.
Yeah.
I face it in government all the time. We get labeled for so many things, but there are so many good things that we're doing too.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's working with your team to thrive on those good things so we get through the bad. And the same thing with your family. You look at the good things that you go through. We had this weekend was a very good weekend for all of us. We spent time with family and we got through, you know, but we get back to work and we understand what we need to do. So, you know, just we're going to continue to be different people. We're going to continue to have different views. I always tell my team that if two people always think alike, I don't need one of them.
Yeah.
You know, and that's true. You're just, I don't want people who think alike. Yeah. We need to challenge each other. We need to help each other. We need to continue to understand that people are important. Every single body we meet, that's why we get where we are, because we know people, we network. We cannot do anything without people, you know?
Yeah.
So just cherish everybody that you meet. There's something that you learn from each and everybody that you meet every day.
Yeah.
And at some point, I'm still learning some of the lessons my mother tried to teach me. Like, she's gone now, but sometimes I say, oh, that is what she was trying to tell me.
Yeah.
You know, so she's probably smiling and saying, aha, now you know you get it.
Right?
Now
you get it.
So, you know, it's just at some point you learn, you'll understand what that message was. So it's important for us to listen and hear, not just listen but hear. You know? So those are things you can't tell people what to do. You can't control what other people do except yourself. I'm the only one that I can control what my own daughter does, you know? So once you're at peace with yourself and understanding where you are and how you contribute to life, and don't lose sight of your values, what you hold dear to you. And for me, it's just this gratitude. I'm always grateful every single day that I get up, every single day. So,
thank you so much for being with us. You have been an inspiration to me, and I know that you're inspirational to the women that we have watching us today. So thank you for coming and joining us today.
Nice to meet you too. Andrea, we have to tell your mind, you put me on the spot.
Well, she done used to me, right? She know I like that. I did it to Emery's too, and she almost killed me for it. Okay, so we have to take a short break, and then we will come back and introduce our next guest that we have with us this morning. So don't go anywhere, people. We will come right back. So thanks again, Sharon. No, but no, yeah, yeah. Thanks for being with us.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
It's a daytime show, and it empowers women to embrace the extraordinary and go against the grain of the common.
I really like the sound of that.
Yeah, I knew you would like it, because it's a really fun show.
It sounds that way.
It's a mixture of tears and laughter and challenges and human interest stories.
Well, you know what? I might just give it a shot.
Well, let's go.
All right, let's go. Hi, guys. Alida and I want to invite you to join us on Tuesdays at 10:30 for a new season of Life Uncommon on Plus TV. You do not want to miss what 2017 will bring. It's going to be awesome.
It sure will.
Dad, I'll take Boardwalk off your hands for $1,000. It's almost triple.
Nope.
Okay, fine. I'll give you $2,000 plus the utilities. Take it or leave it.
Is that all you got?
Okay. I know you won't refuse this.
What's good barbecue worth to you? Grace barbecue sauce.
Something that I always wanted to do, but when it's like when you don't know what to expect, you have this kind of fear and you never really do it. I decided, you know what, just make a phone call. That's all, you know, you need to do. At least a phone call, find out what it's about, and then you can go from there, but at least inform yourself first. And I called, and surprisingly, it was really easy. I didn't expect to get approved and become a foster parent like in a couple of weeks, and it happened that quick.
I get to watch TV by myself. I get to go to park. I get to go and do life stuff, eat at the restaurant, go out to park and eat ice cream. So I like it right here.
Anybody who wants or who is thinking about doing foster care, they should do it. It doesn't take a lot, the process isn't long. And there's always a child, you know, that needs help. And it doesn't have to be overwhelming, because some children just need you know, an ear to listen to, a shoulder to cry on. You know, it's just, it's more than what most people think it is. Ashanti just flows right in, just like, and my life continue on.
Good morning. Welcome back to Life Uncommon. We are live here in the studio at Plus TV, and we have been talking with women today, or we are talking with women today who are inspirational and just have some things that we felt like would be good for everybody to hear. And mm-hmm. our next guest is someone very special to me. I can't even remember when I first met you. I think it was about 5 years ago. Anyway, our next guest is Ix-Chel Poot. And Ix-Chel was born and raised in Belmopan, right? Yeah. So let me read your bio real quick. I have it.
Here we go.
Yeah. Okay, she is the third of four children and her mother's only daughter. She holds a BA from the University of Belize and a specialization in aging and health. In 2008, she began working with the National Council on Aging as the program officer for the country. And in 2016, she was appointed the executive director at the council. In addition to her work at the council, Ix-Chel is also an author and a poet. Mm-hmm. In 2013, one of her stories was published in Belizean Nail Soup, a collection of short stories. And she was the recipient of the Belize Literary Prize for 2015 for her short story, Mama. In 2016, her tiny story for every child was selected to be a part of UNICEF's Tiny Story Campaign. I remember that was really exciting. Yeah, yeah. So welcome.
Thank you. Good morning, ladies.
I'm glad that you read it because again, Ix-Chel is not the type of person that would be saying all these things about herself. She's probably saying, why do I have to read all of that?
Well, you know, I actually was not going to show up. I was really thinking about telling you people no when Miss Alida messaged me and she said, you know, we're talking about inspirational women. I was like, what have I done that's inspirational? But I was speaking to my coworker, Sharon Valero.
Yeah.
And Sharon said, maybe you don't think that what you do is inspirational, but maybe you're inspiring someone. And she really had me thinking about all the women, all the people that we surround ourselves with who might be inspiring us to something more, and never recognizing that what they are doing is actually moving someone forward.
And I think that's what you are doing.
I think so.
You know, and we have a saying on our Facebook page about this show. One of the things that we are encouraging women to do is to embrace their giftings and talents God has given to them, because we say the world is desperately in need of your gifts and your talents. Mm-hmm. And if you are holding that in and not walking out in that, there's a lack somewhere because you're not doing what you're supposed to do. So that's why we wanted you to come too, because clearly we see that in your life, you are doing those things. So maybe tell us what made you become passionate about the field that you're in?
You know, it was very interesting listening to Mrs. Young talking, because mm-hmm. I could relate to many of the things that she spoke about. Mm-hmm. My mother was widowed when I was 13.
Wow. Okay.
So she raised the four of us on her own.
Okay.
And education was always a big foundation in our life.
Okay.
Both my parents always pushed us to be educated, to know what you want to do.
Yeah.
And when I graduated from high school, I went straight to sixth form. I've always had the predisposition to write.
Okay.
And so I studied English literature at UB.
Okay.
Okay. For my associate's degree, and everybody thought I was going to be an English teacher, which is something I desperately did not want. Not that there is anything wrong with teaching.
Right.
I really admire teachers, and I have many teachers that have created a huge foundation in my life. It's just that I recognized early on that teaching was not for me. Uh-huh. And I went to UB, got my associate's degree, and believe it or not, the National Council on Aging is the seventh in my list of jobs.
Oh, wow.
That I have been, you know, I've been a secretary at one of the ministries, I've worked at the Belmopan City Council, I've worked in Belize City, I've done several different things.
Yeah.
And when I went back to school after my associate's degree, and I went for a bachelor's in English, and everybody told me again I was gonna be a teacher.
Right.
And I had many conversations with God.
Uh-huh.
Long conversations with God about all the things that I was sure that I did not want to do.
Mm-hmm.
And no concept of what I really wanted to do.
Yeah.
And I applied for the position as a program officer at the National Council on Aging, and I got the job, and it fit so many of the things that I liked.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a field that we have very few Belizeans in.
Yes.
It's a growing field looking at our aging population. It was something that was very dear to my heart because my grandmother had Alzheimer's.
Okay.
And I watched her progress through the stages, and I recognized that there were no support systems in place for my mother. There was no hospital care the way that she needed it. Yeah. It was so expensive.
Mm-hmm.
And all of these factors made me realize that there really was a gap when it came to working with older people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Even now, people still think that what I do is provide services.
Uh-huh.
People come to the council a lot asking for services, but what we really do is, our country has a policy on aging, and it's our job to network and to work with the areas in government to ensure that the areas in those policies are put in place so that older people will have better lives, and by extension, we're making the lives of our younger people better.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So,
right.
Yeah, but somewhere along the line, around my third year, when I really settled in and got to understand the components of the job, I really discovered that it was something that I loved and I was passionate about. And we get to work with people who are often forgotten and who are the building blocks of our nation.
Yeah.
In our Adopt a Grandparent program, you know, we had one of the older women, and when we were talking to her, she was the first female draftsman that we had in Belize.
Oh, wow.
You know, we don't talk about things like that.
Yeah.
One of the ladies also in that program, she worked at Ministry of Finance, and she used to do our computer systems to get the payroll together and all of that.
Wow.
You know, and these are women.
Yeah.
That we don't necessarily realize that we have been making strides, and they are women who have created a foundation. But when we meet them later in life when they're retired, we tend to think, oh, that's the little lady that likes to sew.
Yeah.
That's the lady that likes to bake. But
that
is the one chapter of their life that we're seeing,
Mm-hmm.
when there are several other chapters that have been written before we came into this one.
Yeah. I really like that you share that, because it's true. I feel like the way our society handles people once they reach a certain age, it's like the value decreases of that person.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they don't mean that much. They don't have anything to offer anymore.
Yeah.
And I remember going to a meeting where you walked in and you shared so passionately about what you're doing. And I was blown away just listening to you, because you are speaking, yes, facts, but also from the heart. And it really inspired me in that moment, in a simple meeting where you were just sharing what you do.
Mm-hmm.
But I knew that you loved what you were doing. And I was like, that is the key right there. When we as women find that thing we're supposed to do and we give it our all. And I think Sharon mentioned that as well. Do more than you are paid to do, or give more than what you're asked to give.
You know, and that's one of the key things I think that my mother always taught us growing up, that we should never settle for anything less than our best.
Mm-hmm.
You might not be number one, but at the end of the day, you have no regrets.
Yeah.
You have done the best that you can do, and you cannot think about doing anything less. And that's something that I've always strived to do, and it's been difficult.
Yeah.
Because the council is a small unit, there are only two of us.
Okay.
Previously it was myself and Miss Jeffrey, who is another remarkable woman. Miss Lindy came to Belize as a VSO volunteer.
Okay,
what a VSO?
Volunteer overseas.
Okay.
Yeah.
You had to make me think fast just now. But you know, she came over as a volunteer overseas, and she made Belize her home.
Okay.
And she, you know, essentially dedicated the most of her working life into looking at the development of this country.
Yeah.
She retired last year, and now this year I have on our team Miss Rivero, who is, you know, she amazes me constantly with her dedication, the way she moves, the way she conceptualizes and thinks about things from beginning to end, and it's like a non-stop, you know, like you can see the wheels turning. And that kind of passion, I found that it's really helped me with the passion that I have for work and the drive that I have for work. So even though we've been, or I've been in the field for this long, finding that it's, you know, it's renewed, that there are new goals, there are new things that we can go for. And it's very interesting. And I think sometimes we forget that the women we surround ourselves with should be giving us that kind of passion, lighting that kind of fire. And if the people that are surrounding you aren't inspiring you to be more than you already are, then you need to rethink, you know, rethink, what am I doing here? And where is this going to lead me at the end of the day?
I love that. I love that. We do need to think about the people we're surrounding ourselves with. I love the fact that you mentioned your mother and how you were also inspired by your grandmother's health struggles. With the aging population, with the seniors in this country, are the majority of them male, female? What's the makeup?
Worldwide, the figures tend to say that there are more older women than men.
Okay.
In Belize, our ratio comes really, really close, with men being just a little bit more than the women.
Really?
Yes.
Okay.
So it's very interesting. But what we do find is that women will live longer than men.
Okay.
There's several schools of thought as to why. A woman's ability or a woman's probability of accessing health care more than a male.
Okay.
Because when a woman becomes pregnant, she then starts accessing some kind of medical service. A male, however, is rarely prompted at stages in his life, so he might be less likely to access medical services until there is some kind of crisis, and then, you know, it kind of all falls apart. But women will live longer than men, but they will more than likely live with a chronic illness, diabetes, hypertension, or some form of arthritis, which will make later years a little more difficult if you're not actively involved in managing your health.
Right. So it's not just about the length of life, but also about the
quality.
Quality
of life. The saying that we use at work sometimes is not the the years that we add to life, it's the life that we add to years.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we're really trying to do, add life to years.
All right. And I agree with that. Add life to years. I like that because it's so true. And I think it goes right back to what I was talking about earlier when we just opened up the show about savoring the moments and looking at our lives, because the days go by so fast.
Yes.
Very fast.
The years go by fast. And then we come to the end of the year, and we said, how did the year go so fast? But then sometimes we come to the end of our lives and we're like, where did my life go? Like, what did I do? What did I accomplish? And so it's really, my husband says it, that I'm trying to think of how he said, but he talks something similar to that about people are, they're alive, but they're not living.
They're not living.
You know, they're not living at all. It's just going through that motion on a daily basis, but there's no joy, there's no purpose to life or anything like that.
Yeah.
So,
and that's one of the reasons why I wanted to not only highlight your position at the council, but also the your work as a writer, as a poet. Because I think it, you know, it's not, it's also about the quality. It's about what we do with our lives. And part of what we talk about at the show is to use every gift that God has given you. And that's one of the things that I admire about you, is that you keep on using all the gifts, not just what you're doing at work, but the things that God has gifted you with.
I try. I try. Sometimes I feel like I'm not.
Yeah.
Sometimes I'm thinking I should be doing more.
Yeah.
But I try. The short story that won the Belize Literary Prize, Mama, I like to tell people I'm a reluctant writer. I write, but I need to be prompted several times to share my writing. It's very rarely that I will share it of my own, my own initiative. And I have a writing circle that is an incredible group of women as well. My writing circle is Feline Cayetano, Ivory Kelly, Kalila Enriquez. And we write and we share and we talk and we discuss. Yeah. What I love about them is that they're very frank and they're very open. And they will tell me, you know, oh no, that's not working. Don't even, this is, no. You know, and they expect the same kind of honesty and frankness
yeah.
from me.
Yeah. Yeah.
Which is wonderful.
Yeah.
And I shared Mama with them, and it was like the submission is due at midnight on the date, and it was like 10 to 12, and I was getting this firestorm of messages, you know, you should submit your story, should submit your story kind of thing. And I submitted the story, and the story is actually about an older woman. And she wakes up on a very ordinary day, and by the end of the day, her life has changed completely from when she woke up in the morning. And nothing necessarily drastic happens, it's just the way life unfolds. And I've had so many people read it and be able to identify with it. Able to identify with the way life is subtle, but changes so quickly.
Right.
And so, you know, that story was really for me an example of how the work that I do impacts what I do on my downtime, what I create, so to speak.
All right, well, Mariette is watching. Thank you for watching. And she says, good morning, ladies. Happy 1 year anniversary. The guest gives useful advice in a humble way, Christ-like traits. The second guest advice that sticks out is to do your best. We are beautifully and wonderfully made.
We are.
That's right. We certainly are. So what would you say are some of the things that inspires you to write and to live the way that you live?
My high school literature teacher, my high school literature teacher, Mr. Emil Polido, in my very first lit class in third form, said literature is about life. And that stuck with me because I realized that all the stories that we have committed to paper are someone's version of life.
Yeah.
And so I do this thing that I call people watching. Like this weekend I was on the bus and I would look at the people and I tried to decide which chapter of their stories have I met them in. You know, I am on this bus and I know why I'm on this bus, but why are you on this bus? You know? Why are you here? How did this arrive here? You know, one of the things that stood out on my bus trip over the weekend is my sister-in-law sitting on a seat and there was a little boy standing in the aisle and we gave him our seat, a part of our seat.
Yeah.
And his father turns around and looks at him and said, don't go to sleep. Right? And like 5 minutes in, like we both look over and he's going to sleep. I was like, don't go to sleep. Because I don't know where they're getting off the bus and you know, the jostling of the people. But the seats eventually free up and the father gets a seat and of course he moves the boy who is asleep again.
Yes.
And the little boy curls up into his father's arms and goes back to sleep. Like it's something he's always doing.
Yeah.
And you know, you immediately realize that that's a father and his youngest son. And he's still protecting him. Even though the boy looks like he's about seven, you know, it's a, it's a boy, not necessarily a small child. And then you start to think about what are your predispositions. If I had seen this man on the bus without the boy, I would never have attributed these characteristics to him. I would never have thought about him as a father figure holding a sleeping child, protecting on the child, you know. And so those kinds of things make me think about characters and make me think about stories. Sometimes it's stories that I meet at work, the older people that we meet, the ones that we know, and the ones who have been bold enough to share their story or the ones who invite you to be a part of their life in the space that they are. Poetry flows easier than prose writing, than short story writing. Because when you write a short story, you have to decide your characters and where they're going to go. And there are things that I've written that I absolutely hate and delete. But in the most part, I think that literature is about life.
Yeah.
And it's about life as it's surrounding us and changing.
Yeah.
I love the way your outlook about how the chapters of our lives. And you made me think about, oh my goodness, what chapter am I in? And I mentioned a little bit earlier how old my grandmother is. Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm thinking, okay, how many more chapters
do you get to write? How many more do you get to write?
How many more chapters do I get to write?
And how are you going to define them? You know, and that's always something that I've always thought about, you know, how am I going to take today and make sure that I don't regret today?
Mm. Yeah.
You know, because there are days that I regret at 5 p.m. and I go, you know, I've done nothing that I planned to do today. How am I going to save today? And then I go home and today is not saved at all.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that we can all identify with being in spaces of time like that. Because life happens around us and influences us one way or the other.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you, you mentioned earlier about the writing group of women that you're with. And it sounded to me like you all are able to critique one another without being critical of one another. Mm. How do you learn to do that?
I think because as writers, you respect the writing.
Okay. Mm.
Mm-hmm. You respect the writing. One of my lecturers at university used to always say that when you put your pen to paper, you're giving birth.
Mm. Okay.
Respect your child.
Okay.
So you respect the text. So even though they're gonna tell me, oh, you know, this is not a work, it won't be assassination of my style or assassination of my word choice. It will be, you know, we've looked at your story, we've looked at these elements, but this isn't consistent. You really need to think about the voice that you've given this character.
Okay.
Is this character true to form?
Wow.
And, you know, that's kind of a difficult question.
Yeah.
And sometimes when you get critiques like that, you don't touch the work for months because you have to have time to rethink.
Yeah.
So it's an ongoing process, but that's really, I think, how we're able to do that you respect the author,
respect
the writing,
okay.
and you respect the work that's there.
Yeah.
So we could carry that over then into other areas that you respect the person, you respect what it is they're doing.
And that's a very key element in any form of communication, to be able to be critical of something but still respect the person that you are working with. So I might criticize the work but not you.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, so it's a very interesting balance.
Yes, it is.
And I've just really enjoyed listening to you, Ix-Chel. I just love what you've been sharing, and you talk so smooth and just like you can share your thoughts so easily.
Yeah,
it looks easy to us, but we have to wrap up. We are out of time for today, but I do also want to extend to you the same thing I extended to Sharon with. Is there anything that a life lesson or a quote, a verse, something that you would like to share with our viewers that has carried you over the years or is meaningful to you in some way?
Well, there are several. You're asking me to pick one, and it's so difficult. But I think there's, and I can't remember it well, there's a little quote from Doctor Who. That from Dr. Seuss that talks about being you, you, because there's nobody else that can be any newer than you.
Yeah.
Right.
And that's one of the things that I always encourage people. Don't try to be anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Be yourself.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You are good enough, mm-hmm. you are brave enough, you are strong enough.
Yeah.
You just need to be yourself.
Mm.
Now, but before we go, I've got three little things that I want to mention about work.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
We have a caregivers training course coming up. It's the first time that we're doing it in Belmopan.
Oh, great.
We have some scholarships available.
Okay.
So if any of your viewers are in the Belmopan area and would like to participate in the course, they can contact us at the office. It's 822-1546.
Okay.
We have registration forms. And the certification is recognized by the Ministry of Health, the Ministry of Human Development, and the National Council on Aging.
Okay.
So these caregivers are the ones that we are now going to prioritize for placement in jobs of taking care of older persons.
Okay, great.
So
great.
Even though there are no immediate openings, these are the ones that we will be
putting
through. So if any of your viewers are interested, to please contact the office. We have another cycle after the cycle that starts in March 20th. So maybe if you can't make it to March 20th, you can probably catch us in Belize City party at the second cycle.
Okay.
And then in honor of Women's Month on March 29th, we'll be having a sexual health and aging workshop for women 50 and older.
Oh, wow.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So we're going to be sharing our flyer and our information. That's going to be free of cost. We have a limited space for the workshop, but we're hoping to have a full health fair in the afternoon. We're still finalizing venue because there's several components that we want to put together. And then coming up in June, we're doing an elder abuse awareness drive.
Okay.
And we're asking members of the community to donate to us a pack of adult-sized Pampers, a bottle of Ensure, or bars of soap.
Okay.
And that's going to be distributed to vulnerable older persons within the district, or if we get enough, we're going to go extend outside of Belmopan. We're really hoping to hit two districts this year.
Okay.
Last year, we only did Cayo District. Okay. So that's just some of the things we have coming up at work that your viewers might be interested in participating in.
Yeah, and we'll have to highlight each of those things on our on our Facebook page. Yeah. So,
Well, do you want to thank our sponsors? We have to go.
Thank you to Grace Kennedy Belize. Thank you to Roots and Honor Records. And to who else?
The Ministry of Human Development, right?
Yes.
Yeah. With the foster a child.
Yeah, everybody. Give your heart to a child. And thank you to Cirillo, and thank you to Brian. Thank you to everybody that's watching, and to the guests that we've had this morning. Thank you all so much. It's been, we couldn't do the show without you.
Yep, that's right. So everybody will be back here again next week. So don't go anywhere next week. All right, make sure you guys tune in, because we will be having another writer coming on to next week, and makeup and all
makeup
kinds
tips.
Of stuff.
Yes, yes. So very exciting.
Tune in then. All right, take care, everybody. We'll see you guys next week.